Good morning. Congratulations, René, first, because when I was in Copenhagen 32 years ago, I was in Copenhagen as a young chef, and I had the privilege to discover this city and the talent already there. And there were some very interesting pillar building up the what certainly Copenhagen is and all those young, ambitious chefs here. I was working with a chef called Jan Hurtigal, and Jan Hurtigal was started his first restaurant, a small place, and we were only four in the kitchen, in a very tiny kitchen, and that was maybe the most exciting time I had. I decided to come to America and leave Denmark, otherwise I'll be Danish by now, with certainly a family of little Danish boy. And who knows, maybe some Danish chef. But I'm here to present a very interesting chef, also Danish chef, Rasmus Kofoed, from Geranium. And Rasmus, I am involved with Bocuse d'Or USA, and Bocuse d'Or USA is the body who manage the competition in Lyon. I'm from Lyon, and I've been a big fan of Paul Bocuse, but also he has been a mentor to me. And one day he asked me, he said, you know, America is not doing too well in the Bocuse d'Or, and I want you to take care of it, and I want Thomas Keller to be the president, and I want one day America to be on the podium. So Paul Bocuse is 86, and we hope that one day we will be on the podium. But at the same time, there were other countries who had done much better over the year, and especially Scandinavia. And Rasmus, who has been representing Denmark among other chefs, has done the most ever done by a young chef in this competition. And first, he won in 2005, he won the bronze, which I'm sure they're gonna bring, the bronze is on the right here. Then in 2007, he won the silver on the left. And in 2011, he won the gold in the middle. But in between, in 2010, he also won the gold in Europe, which is basically like Spain last night, who won the UEFA Cup. And Rasmus was a young apprentice at the Hotel d'Angleterre here, who right now is closed for renovation. But he was an apprentice at d'Angleterre, and after he won the bronze, was asked to be the chef de cuisine for that hotel. He did it for a short while. But like many chefs, hotels are kind of the things where you may learn things, but you don't really want to be there forever. And to have done what he has done, it takes an incredible focus, dedication, starvation. I mean, he basically had give up everything he had in order to try to succeed, and especially when in 2007, he thought he had the gold, and actually the French won the gold. And so he said, I have to come back for it. And he went down and opened his restaurant in 2009, he opened his restaurant and was doing both at the same time, working hundreds and hundreds, thousands of hours to try to win this competition. At the end, does it make him a better chef? I think it makes him unique. That's what it's very, very special. And I just want to say also that he's a proud father of a 4 months, Camille, his young daughter who was born 4 months, who's 4 months old. And I just wish him luck. Take care. Thank you. Vas-y, Rasmus. Rasmus. Thank you.
Good afternoon. And thank you for that lovely introduction. I'm so proud, I'm so honored to be here on stage today in my lovely hometown, Copenhagen. It's a great honor for me to see so many great chefs, journalists, food bloggers, and food lovers. By my side, I have the fantastic Mr. Søren Liedet, and he will assist me with doing, show you the examples and do the cooking. So actually, I will do the talking and Søren will do the cooking today. So we switch. I hope it's all right. And first, I have a small bite, a small taste from the restaurant, and it's served in a small boat. And this afternoon, you will two in that boat together, so you will share. And it's crispy branches made from a local cheese, a little touch of ash made from burned leeks. You will find a walnut oil mayonnaise. And to clean the palate, it's that beautiful sorrel flower. And I hope you will enjoy that one. And also, I have made a small movie with some impressions and memories from my last journey. And it's to tell you and show you what has been going on in my head the last decade. So if you please will start the movie, and yeah, it's like going to the cinema.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. In total, I have spent more than 9 years of preparation in order to reach my dream. And why would you probably ask me? And I will see if I can answer that question. First of all, I'm a little bit mad. I'm not a freak, I'm just a little bit mad. I was kicked out of school in second grade when I was 8 years old, and it was not because I was evil, I just had such a high level of energy. I was fighting with the boys in school, and I still remember the spicy flavor the two Indian twin girls had when we tongue-kissed. I was 8 years old. We also had a rock band in a hen house, and maybe that was too much for a Rudolf Steiner school. I don't know. In my new school, I was suddenly the new kid, the shy kid. I was a little guy, and it was a big school, and I start to feel some demons. Demons working in my stomach and telling me that I have to fight more for everything to show my worth. When I found something at school I really enjoyed, I wanted to be the best. And even if it was making handicraft from copper or playing hockey, me against five, I would do anything. I would do anything to win. I have always been fascinated with creating an image in my head and transform it with my hands to make it visible. I believe it's one of the best gifts we humans have, to express our deeper thoughts without saying any words. Therefore, when I fell in love back in 93, and this time it was not with an exotic girl, it was with a picture from the great Danish chef Jens Peter Kolbæk's silver Bocuse d'Or winning platters. What an explosion of creativity I saw. Turbot stuffed with smoked scallops, foamy vanilla sauce, milfoil of beef tenderloin in layers with folk rind truffle. These pictures started a burning fire right in here, right in my heart. And I began to realize that I could only be satisfied in my life if I one day could win the biggest ego trip competition, the World Championships of Cooking, the Bocuse d'Or. I started my planning in 2003, right after I won the Danish Chef of the Year competition. I remember that René went number five in that one. And I spent all my money on traveling to new countries to watch different competitions and improve my knowledge about them. On the way, I lost a girlfriend that I had been together with for 6 years. And I felt sad, very sad, because I really loved her. But in another way, I felt released and more free to give the competition 100% attention instead of the 95% that I used to do. The main theme for the Bocuse d'Or is typically announced 1 year before the final, and the garnish is free of your own choice. I focus on design, I focused on the presentation, I focus on my personality in the food, the consistency, the origin, and the taste. A typical day of training would start with playing around and searching for something new. It could be a shape, it could be a technique. Sometimes the idea starts up being really far out, but I believe it's a great way to wake your creativity, and the playful work with strange ideas was very important in order to reach the more precise and the right idea. After a long day in my kitchen, I like to look inside myself and recall the images of the day. I look through them and I work them over in my brain again and again and again until I see them in their purest form. As one of the results, I have developed a special piece of smoked and dried breast of lamb together with an organic butcher, Slagter Jens from Koltol, amazing guy, amazing products. I think you will try, you have maybe already tried them here in Copenhagen. And it was to bring some kind of national flavor and national aroma to my dishes, something that would underline my culinary background. And we will just pass it around. It's that beautiful smoked and dried breast of lamb. You can enjoy the aroma. That's a scissor. You can cut yourself a bite. And it's the Viking chewing gum. And this one here is the example. It was one of the garnishes for the Bocuse d'Or competition, the meat actually. Søren, you are doing a really nice job there. Thank you. And the soup is made from that smoked and dried breast of lamb. And here in that specially designed glass bowl, it's specially designed for that dish. It's also a dish we served in a restaurant. And it's designed with a Danish glassblower to give some kind of national touch to the presentation. And in that bowl, you will find simply peas cooked with butter, little touch of salt to bring a pure flavor. On top, you will find pickled flowers, and it's leek flowers, hip rose flowers, and pickled elder flowers. On the very top, different herbs and different flowers, fresh too. So that's the first example, this one here. Can you see it up there? Maybe you can take a picture from this one. So the first one. Thank you. Thank you. The next example, do you enjoy the lamb? Do you enjoy the Viking chewing gum? Just cut yourself a small bite. It's a nice flavor. The next example, it's the biodynamic beetroot, aged apple vinegar, and hazelnuts. In my head, I have been in conversation with a beetroot for almost a year before the final. And I was not, I know it sounds strange being in conversation with a beetroot, but it's actually the truth. And I was not sure if it was qualified to go with me to the final competition. I mean, it was just a beetroot. It was not a truffle, but I discovered that it was even more than that. I ended up using biodynamic beetroot from my local farmer, Ask from Kieselgården, and he has the best beetroot that I have ever tasted in my life. A perfect structure and a perfect balance between the sweetness and the earthiness. I cooked them whole, just with the skin on. I would let them rest just like a big piece of meat. And then, with a special cutter, I will make them long and round. And also, to make them more functional, I wrapped a jelly made from an aged apple vinegar around them to give some contrast to the sweetness. And finally, they will be sprayed with fresh beetroot juice with a touch of apple juice and a touch of apple vinegar. And here is this one, also some crispy hazelnuts on top, soaked in milk, added a little bit of salt, and a touch of hazelnut oil, some beetroot sprouts, and this is a crisp, to give a crispy contrast too, it's a very thin dough painted with squid ink to give a crispy detail. And the puree is made from beetroot juice too with apple vinegar. Thank you. This is also a garnish in the restaurant. We have been serving it as a snack and also a garnish for a lobster dish. Maybe you have seen it already if you have been there. Many people have supported me during the years. Friends, chefs, Søren, girlfriends, family. But in the end, my success depended on me and my belief in myself. I need to be in perfect mental balance to have the confidence to face the challenge. So I trained physically, I ate healthy food, I ran to get in good shape, and always with a picture of the gold in the horizon, just to push myself to the limit. I was obsessed with everything that could make my mind stronger. I believe that being in control in the situation would give me more energy on the competition day to show the audience and the judges my love and my strong joy and deep passion for cooking. My confidence was growing. I started to believe that I could be the only winner next time. I was imagining how I would react when I had won. Would I cry? Would I jump in the air? Or would I stay more in control? Control was a difficult word, especially in the beginning when it comes to the monkfish. I think I spent more than 2,500 hours to search to find the deepest secret to control that monster of a fish with that beautiful texture. I remember, and that was in the beginning, that I tried to wrap a string around the fillet, put a skewer through it, freeze it, and I tried to fry it when it was still a bit frozen, and it was just to discover that it will still twist on the pan and lose all that amazing moisture. That was not a good idea. My final and the very best result was to put it back where it came from, and that's the salty water. I let it have a swim in 10% salt brine for 25 minutes. I dry it gently. I roll it in powder made from burnt hay to bring some kind of smoke dimension to the fish, which is very interesting, and also to create the illusion of the original dark monkfish skin. I cook the fish with brown butter until 50 degrees, in a 50 degrees water bath, until 42 degrees in the center, right with the bones. And here's the example here. And in the end, just before the serving, I glaze it with browned onions, brown butter, dyes, morels, lots of them, and presented it whole like this one here. So if you can just show. I think it's a quite beautiful piece of fish. I hope you agree. I cut the fish from the bone just before the presentation for the judges and burned a very thin crust over that piece of very juicy and tender fish. It's to give it heat, of course, and to release the aroma and to give it a roasted flavor. And this is beautiful job, Søren. I think you can compete next time for the Bocuse d'Or.
There you go.
Why? Finally, when I won the competition, after 9 years of focus and 3 times of trying, I realized that I was out of my prison. I was out of my own personal Bocuse d'Or prison. I felt free, and I was, of course, amazingly happy. I was happy to win 3 trophies as the only one in the world. But on the other side, I felt a little bit sad too, because I realized that my adventure had come to an end. Thank you.
Brilliant.
Okay, have we got questions for Rasmus?
Not about the recipes, they are too complicated.
Okay, not about the recipes, but about the application and detail and technique and devotion that it takes to be the world number one. Who would like to ask Rasmus about that? Well, I'm going to ask you a quick question until somebody thinks of another one. What did you sacrifice? You spent 9 years striving to get to this. Mm-hmm. Obviously you had to sacrifice a relationship. What else did you sacrifice in your life during that time?
I don't know if I sacrificed really anything, because it's just being a part of my life and me growing up in that culinary world. And I mean, maybe I could see my friends and the family a bit more. But I mean, I'm doing what I love, and that's important, I think.
Okay.
So I don't regret any minute, actually.
Good, 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 good. We have a question down here. If you can just wait till the microphone. Stand out in the front.
I think you're the kind of person that needs a challenge. So what is your new challenge?
I just got a small daughter 4 months ago. And that's a quite big challenge, I discover. To make her happy and the mom at the same time, it's difficult. I need some challenges in my life, of course, but I'm getting older too. I mean, I was 25 almost when I started with that competition, and there's a lot of challenges in your life. I'm about to make a new book, and you know, I focused a lot in my restaurant and being a good father, and yeah. Getting inspiration from the nature and my love for gastronomy.
Yeah, maybe you could enter the competition for world's best dad. Maybe that one.
maybe it could be a good one.
In about 9 years. Anyone got any other questions? Any other questions for Rasmus? Yes, over here.
Yeah. Rasmus, what was the most challenging thing for the last competition in Lyon?
I think the most challenging thing is to believe yourself so strongly. I mean, and I have big dreams, and believe the big dreams is and to reach them, it's quite complicated. So, you know, I'm planning a lot the organization about how to win, but also that training period, which is a long time before the competition, it's very inspiring, and I use it in my restaurant. So, I mean, it would never be a waste of time. I mean, you develop new things, you learn, and you improve, and I think that's really interesting.
Okay, we've got time for...
Yeah, I've got one.
Sorry?
Here?
Over
Hello.
Here.
Yes. Can I ask you, are you still skating? You've got more time now?
Yeah, you need a kickflip?
Yes, you can do it?
Well, it's a skateboard, I can do it. No.